Our next presentation is from Grammy Award winning songwriter, keyboardist, session musician, and traveling musician, touring musician, Gary Corbett. He's had an eclectic career, and that's to say the least. He's going to talk about the changes in the music industry. He's worked with the band Cinderella. He's one of the founding members. Worked with the band Kiss, and worked with all of the Marley Brothers. And Bob Marley's... Ziggy? Well, come up here. Gary Corbett, thank you so much for coming.
When I first was asked to come here to speak and speaking about change in the music business, I wanted to talk a little bit about how change is actually a good thing and something that should be embraced, and how, you know, in this business that's really tough, when you hit a roadblock, you know, you make a little turn and you find your way and all of that stuff. And then, since I've been here, I've realized that a lot of the things I take for granted as the basis of this business are things that most people here haven't experienced or aren't even aware used to be the way things were done. So first I want to start off with a little bit about the way this business used to operate so that you understand how it got to where it is and how you could make it what you want it to be for the future. So, you know, the industry, like when I was growing up, it was an industry of record labels, agencies. Everybody had a say in what the artists did. And you couldn't make a record without a record company giving you money, and basically you had to deliver them a product that they were happy with. You would then go out on tour and promote the record, and you know, you had a producer, you had different people doing all the different jobs for you. And now, with the internet and Facebook, and you have the ability to be in complete control of everything that you do. And it's a very freeing way to work, and it's, you know, the possibilities are endless. But it's very important to look back and see what's come before to A, not repeat mistakes, and B, maybe come up with a new way of doing something that's innovative and unique, because that's really what, that's the common thing in this business. You know, you have to have a unique product. Another common thing that everybody's mentioned today is how hard you have to work. This business requires total dedication. You really, you know, lots of sleepless nights, lots of changes in direction, lots of disappointments. But you always have to trust yourself, and you always have to push through the difficult times. And it's hard sometimes, you know, and especially in a day where you're responsible for all of it. And everything that is related to your business is coming from you. Like I said, in the old days, you would get signed to a record label. And the record company would hire a producer who would then go in the studio with the band, direct them, and record the record, and then deliver it to the record label. The record label could turn around and say, well, you know, we don't really hear a hit, so go back in the studio. That doesn't exist now, because if you're self-recording and you're self-promoting, you're the only person whose opinion affects the final outcome. This is a business of friends and relationships. And a lot of that has disappeared through the years because of technology. And it's important to have friends in places that you trust. You know, and as you develop your business experiences, you'll come in contact with people who you develop relationships with. And those are going to be the people who you turn to for opinions and for collaboration, which is a very important thing, which is also disappearing in this industry, the collaboration between musicians and creative people, and the social aspect of the business, which used to take place largely in the studios and in the venues. You know, you'd bump into people anywhere you were, but now with people being so isolated in where they work and how they work, it's very difficult to make contact with people and to keep that the social channels open to be able to be creative. And it's very important to connect with people who think the way you, not necessarily think the way you do, but basically resonate with what you do. You know, I don't write lyrics. So if I want to write a piece of music with lyrics, I have a few people who I've developed relationships with through the years that I could turn to with a piece of music and say, write lyrics. But I, you know, it's very important to have these people to do what you don't do. I'm getting very nervous here because I'm not really comfortable speaking in front of a room of people like this. And so I really would like to ask if there's any, you know, questions that anybody has. I mean, I'm not really here to talk about my career and my accomplishments. I really want to share my knowledge with people. So if there's anything that anybody has any questions about.
What do you think was the biggest thing for you that you learned through your experiences that helped you make it to where you are now? Maybe even if you couldn't think of just one, like two or three.
Well, like I said, you know, it's really important to be able to change. And it's really important to be flexible. And it's really important to be open-minded. It's, it's an industry of, like a lot of people have said today, it's an industry of a lot of negativity. You're going to get a lot of negative responses from people. You're going to have a lot of people tell you no. But if you trust your gut and you know what it is that you're going for, and you don't get discouraged by those things, then you could, you know, push your way through and stay true to yourself. And eventually there'll be somebody who recognizes what you do, you know, and then that's somebody who you develop a relationship with. And that's what I'm trying to convey here, is that it's really a social business that has kind of been changed in a way because the social elements have been removed. You know, the internet is a great thing. It's a great tool. It's a great marketing tool. It's how everybody that's spoken today has talked about how they market themselves, and it's important, and it's the way it's done today. But it hasn't always been the way it's been done, and it's a really tough thing for people to understand how it went, the way things used to happen, and it's really difficult for me being in this business as long as I have. You know, it was very evolutionary. All my life growing up, the recording studios existed. There were places that we worshiped and couldn't wait to get in when we finally were able to. And when you finally got there, you felt like you were successful, and you went to these places and there you were able to record quality product. But because of the computers and everything else, those things have disappeared. But what's also gone away by them going away is the social aspect. You know, a lot of my work came from people who I bumped into while I was working with somebody else. You walk out of the room, you walk into the coffee machine, and you bump into somebody who's working in the next room, and you say, can you come and play on my record? Yeah, could you come and play on mine? And you swap and you become friends, and then that's how you develop a relationship. But that is no longer the way things are done. So how do you bump into people to collaborate with? It's a totally different place. And it's really important for people to be networking with each other and collaborating with each other, because not everybody can do everything. But unless you're in a place where you're going to be bumping into people and socializing with people, it doesn't happen. And so it's very important that you establish those relationships and friendships. And like I said, it's a business of friendships and relationships. It always has been. At every level, it's that way. And so it's definitely a key aspect of the business. Yes.
You work mostly by yourself in a studio at home. You live in Nashville.
Yes.
Doesn't that happen in Nashville?
Doesn't what happen in Nashville?
The networking.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, that's why I live in Nashville, because it's one of the few places left where there's still some recording studios. A lot of the recording studios are gone. That happened because rather than spending $1,500 a day to go into a recording studio, when people could record at home with their computers, it's definitely the way people would prefer to work these days. Nobody wants to spend $1,500 a day for a recording studio. But it's a necessity to be able to do that type of work. And I do, I have a studio in my house, and I will sit at home and work in my studio, and I'll receive tracks from people through email where I'll play keyboards and I'll never even meet them. And it's very odd to be creative with somebody when you're never in a face-to-face situation with them. It's like, how do you get to know somebody? It used to be, you know, a band was a thing that was, when you became part of a band, it was almost like being on a sports team or a gang or some kind of camaraderie that happened between everybody. And it was all for one and one for all. And that's part of what made it fun, you know? When the bands were rehearsing, if you were working on music, the creativity would come from anybody that was in the room. But if there's only one person in the room, if that one person's creativity or mood or whatever just goes down a little bit, the whole situation stalls. And that could be a problem, you know? So it's really important to be connected to people at the same time, even though technology has made it necessary to work at home and in isolated situations. There's also the technology to connect with people and be able to collaborate, even online with video and everything now, so that you can be in two locations and still write a song together with face-to-face contact. And I think that's really important as well. You know?
Has the pace of the industry changed because of technology, like getting back to people and things like that in your world?
The pace of the industry has changed because things happen so fast. The access is fast. You have access to music immediately. As soon as you finish a song, you can put it out, and you have worldwide distribution. You also don't have to wait until you have a CD pressed to put it out. It's, you know, everything is so instant. But at the same time, there's also no central place. They used to be record stores. Anybody remember record stores? And that was, you know, that was the place where you would go to find out your new music, you know, what was new. And it was as much about the social, once again, the social aspect of that. You know, even if you just knew the salesperson at the record store, you'd walk in and say, hey, what's new this week? Is there anything good? And they'd know your taste. They'd say, hey, check this out, check that out, check this out. And you'd walk, and sometimes if you knew them well enough and you bought something that they recommended before and you liked it, you'll just take their recommendations. But being able to stand in the record store and thumb through and see the new records and see, that was how it was all done. And then you'd had the radio, which determined what the hits were. You know, there were people in charge of every aspect of it. And even the bands had to answer to the record companies. Like I was saying before, you know, it was very common to work on a record. And I'm not even talking about first-time artists. I'm talking about big-name acts that would go into a studio. You record a record. You submit the record to the record company. And the A&R guy said, we don't hear the hit single. Could you go in the studio and cut a couple more songs? You had to do it. And a lot of times they were right. A lot of times it caused a lot of friction between the artists and the record companies because, you know, the artists believe they know what's best and the record company believes they know what's best. The record company people were largely people who were ex-musicians or not musicians at all, and so the artists didn't necessarily respect what they were saying, but they had the checkbook, and so you had to listen to them. And there was a hierarchy that that had to be followed. And it sort of guaranteed a certain level of quality, a certain, you know, and a certain level of professionalism in the recordings. But then it took radio to determine, or MTV later on, what was a hit. Once the song was a hit and on the radio, then people would go to the store to buy the CD or the record before that. Now it's a business of, you have to go out and look for new music. You have to go out and find the stuff you like. There are Spotify and Pandora and all of those services which have music to find. But when you first log into Pandora, it's based on a choice that you make. Then they'll play songs that are similar, but it's still based on a choice that you make. How do you become aware of something that you don't know exists when you don't know it exists? And so it takes a lot more research on the part of the listener to go find things that are good and that they like. It's really difficult, and that's why it's really important for artists, like Anthony was saying, the branding of an artist is really important, because it's how you're going to get recognized. And so, you know, there are a lot of things that are different, but there's a lot that's still the same, and it's, think that aspect of it is still the same. And being creative in how you market things, and it's getting harder and harder, I think, because with the internet there are so many options available of how you could go about doing something, but it's always the ones that do it first that get the most attention. You know, when Kickstarter first started, you thought, wow, what a great idea, and the first few big campaigns that you heard about were very successful. But once it becomes something that people are used to hearing about, I don't think it's as effective anymore. To, you know, now you got to come up with what the next idea is. And I think that because of the nature of the internet, it's also people's attention spans are shorter in what they're willing to pay attention to. And so how do you grab their attention within the first 20 seconds of them being there? And it's hard. And I don't see that in the music sites yet. Do you have any?
I do have a thought.
Absolutely.
You and I have talked a lot since we met yesterday. So Gary's got the song that has sold 7 million copies in the U.S. And we spoke to a bunch of people yesterday who had no idea what the song was. It's She Bop by Cyndi Lauper, which I have a familiar story with in my family, and it was a very cool moment. So, you know, we fight to get 1,000 views on YouTube or something like that, or Facebook, and 100 likes even. We're like, yeah. I mean, this is the scope of a song getting bought 7 million times is outrageous. What in the song do you think sold it so much? What about writing a song makes it a hit?
I like to think it was what I did. Well, I wrote the music for that song. And that song was written pretty much experimentally. Once again, it was the technology. And I'm a huge fan of technology. I've always used it. And, you know, that song was written by connecting a drum machine to a synthesizer and me holding down a chord and the drum machine making the bass line happen because of the beat that we had programmed. And it was an accident. It was one of those things that happen all the time. You know, it's those happy accidents in the studio while you're creating the things that you don't expect to happen, that you need to, like, whoa, that sounds really cool. Just because it was a mistake doesn't mean you should discount it and erase it. Sometimes those are the things that make the best hooks. Because a hook could be anything that can grab your ear. You know, it doesn't have to be a great melody. Sometimes it's a sound that just is so abrasive and dissonant to everything else that's going on that's the thing that catches your ear. And that's still a hook. And it's, you know, then you remember the song because of that sound, you know? Like the Cher, Life After Love. I guarantee you that her use of the auto-tune effect, which is the big hook of that song and has been for countless other artists since then, was an accident when it first happened. Because I used that effect in the studio, and what it was developed for was to actually correct people's pitch when they were singing out of pitch. And so when you turn the knobs a little bit more than you should, that was the sound that happened. And so that's why when the first time I heard it, I know exactly what happened in the studio because it happened to me countless times, but I wasn't smart enough to go, hey, that sounds really cool. I was like, just like, oh, gotta back that down a little bit, you know. But that's, you know, that's it. It's just, so getting back to the Shebop thing, when we wrote that music, I was trying to come up with a riff and a groove that was kind of somewhere between the theme from the original Batman TV series back in the 70s, you know, or Peter Gunn, or, you know, one of those old, cool detective show sort of themes. And that was the driving force behind, you know, that piece of music. And like I was telling you yesterday, that was a piece of music that we didn't even think enough of after the initial writing of that the music track to finish it, you know? And it took Cindy coming in to actually do vocals on a couple of other songs that we wrote to actually say, hey, you know what? I really like that piece of music and I want to rewrite the lyrics and do it on my record. And so we said, yeah, take it. We didn't think much of it, you know? And so, you know, fortunately for us, the rest of the record she made was pretty awesome and she had some good success with it, you know? And it was funny because that was the third single off the album. The first was Girls Just Wanna Have Fun, then just Time After Time. And I remember all the people from the record company that I was talking to were like, oh, we love Shebop, it's gonna be the next single. And all I could think of was, oh my gosh, my song is gonna be the one that's gonna be the anchor that starts the downslide after the number two and the number one hit, and now all of a sudden, you know, I don't wanna be that guy, but, you know, unfortunately it ended up working out. But you never know where those things are gonna come from. And, yes?
But how do you go from, say, working with Cyndi Lauper to working with the Marley family?
Well, you're talking about a 20-year gap between. From Cindy's record, with the first royalty check I got from Cindy's record, I bought an Apple IIe computer, which was the first computer that was used to make music. It was a brand new technology. Nobody had used it yet. I had read about it in Keyboard Magazine, and I was a total gadget and toy freak. And so I used my first royalty check from Shebop to buy an Apple computer, a DX7 keyboard, which was the newest thing at the time, and a Tascam 4-track Porter Studio, so that I could continue to write at my house and, you know, and not have to go to someone else's place to write. And from there, I started programming, which became the way records were done in the 80s. Everything in the 80s was drum machine and computer, and that's why all of those songs, when you listen to them now, sound so stiff, because the technology wasn't advanced enough for the computer to actually have a decent musical feel, and that became the talent of the programmer to try to program in a little bit of that. There wasn't much you could do with it, but because it was a new technology, people kind of liked it anyway, and I guess at the time that was the quirky weirdness that made people like it, you know, the fact that it was kind of stiff and robotic, and it became, you know, like what people considered dance music at the time. But I worked in the studios doing that type of work, and again, that's work that you do by yourself, and as a musician and always playing in bands, I missed the camaraderie of a band, I missed the creative interplay that happens in a band, and I just missed playing live in front of people. And so I was working at a studio in New York City, Electric Lady, which was built by Jimi Hendrix, and it was a place I had always dreamed of working, and I started working there pretty much on a regular basis. And once again, at the coffee machine, I bumped into a keyboard player who was working in another room, who had just finished playing on what was the latest Kiss record at the time. And I told him, I said, you know, I'm really getting burnt out on sitting in the studio alone, having to create music by myself. And I'm really getting the itch to go out on the road, play some music, and kind of recharge my creative flow. And I knew that, you know, even if I did it 6 months after I was out on the road, I'd be wanting to get back in the studio. You know, I always have to have a change. It's always got to be evolving. But that led me to going out on tour with first the singer from Foreigner, Lou Graham, who had just put out a solo record. And before I never even got to stop home at the end of his tour, I flew straight to LA and started rehearsing with Kiss. And that kind of led me to, you know, one tour. See, that's that again, this is the social aspect of the business, you know. So I did that Kiss tour in 87, and before the end of that tour even happened, I got a phone call from a friend of mine, also from the studio, who said, hey, I'm working with this young girl named Debbie Gibson, who's about to go out on her second tour, and she needs a musical director, and I recommended you. And so that's how I ended up going, you know, and I ended up being her musical director on the Electric Youth Tour, which was, I guess, 1989, 90? And yeah. But again, I brought computers on the road and tried to use all the technology, and it, you know, it was still a nightmare to do, but we did it. But as far as the computers go, back then the computer was still just a tool that we used just like we would use a synthesizer or something else. It wasn't the center of how the music was made the way it is now. And that just, one thing just leads you to the next, you know, and that's where the social aspect comes in, is because, you know, you always have to keep in touch with the people who you come in contact with. You need to be able to, you know, have your go-to people that when something's winding down and you're about to look for your next job, you should have a Rolodex or a, you know, a phone book in your phone or whatever it is that you, wherever you keep your numbers, of people you know that are also doing the same thing that you're doing and, you know, are willing to help. And that goes back to the AJ thing of the altruism and helping people. That's always been a part of the business. You know, I have tons of friends that do different things than I do. They'll play, some are guitar players, you know, all the musicians I work with. And we have arrangements with each other that if so-and-so is working on a project and they need keyboards and they're doing it for themselves, I'll do it for them. But I also know that when I need guitar on something, I could call them and they'll do it for me. And that's the way the business works. It's always been a business of friendship. But, you know, don't think that the friendship thing is taken lightly in the business, because it's really probably how more jobs are gotten than any other way. You know, people used to answer ads in New York City in the Village Voice. In the back, they used to have ads when bands were looking for musicians. And they'd put out this cattle call audition thing, and, you know, 200 guys would show up. But they were only doing that because they kind of had to, because at the end of the day, somebody in the band knew somebody who they said, hey, you know what, so-and-so just recommended this guy, why don't we bring him in? And that's usually who got the job. It wasn't the cattle call people that came in cold without having any friend connection to the situation. So, you know, I can't stress enough the social aspect of it. The being willing to be flexible is really, really important. You know, you've heard everybody say today that, you know, there's a lot of people going to say no to you. And that's true. And it's really hard to take sometimes, you know, especially if it happens without a yes ever happening. You know, it could be very discouraging. But you can't let it be discouraging because, you know, at the end of the day, the person telling you no, it's just an opinion. It really is nothing more than an opinion. It's their opinion, and to them it's valid. But if it's not valid to you, then go to the next person. And eventually, or hopefully, you'll find the person that thinks like you, and that's the person that you'll develop a long-term relationship with, that you'll keep going back to throughout your entire career. Any other questions?
Fresh out of time.
Oh, out of time already? Boy, time flies when you're having fun.